Oh, that's just a reminder popping through to say that the meeting's being recorded. So just bear that in mind if your screen is being displayed, and if you don't want to be seen on the recording, you might want to close off your screen. Just a reminder as well to everybody to make sure you're muted while you're on the Zoom call. Welcome. My name's Robert Sims. I'm one of the two Green MLCs in the South Australian Parliament. And I want to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land that I'm on tonight, the Kaurna people. We've got people joining us from around the country. And so I also want to acknowledge traditional owners in different parts of the country as well. I'm really excited tonight to be joined by three really impressive people who are experts in this field around electric vehicles and taxation regimes. I've got Sam Hibbins here, who's the member for Paran in the Victorian Parliament. I've got Christine Milne AO, who is a former leader of the Greens and also a Global Greens ambassador. And then I've got Noah Schultz-Byard, who is the SA director of the Australia Institute. So a terrific group of people that have joined us. In terms of background, tonight's discussion is about where to next for electric vehicles, and in particular, looking at the electric vehicle tax that's been proposed by the South Australian government. We had kind of hoped last year when the government first put this tax forward on the agenda that it would be killed off pretty quickly, because the Parliament made it clear there wasn't support for it. And the Greens, along with the Labor Party, came out pretty swiftly and said that this wasn't going to get a green light for very obvious reasons. But then in the budget that was handed down a few months ago, the State Treasurer announced, lo and behold, that an electric vehicle tax was still going to be part of the budget. But as of yet, we haven't seen any legislation. But this is coming, of course, at a really bizarre time. We've seen the IPCC report that was handed out last night, looking at the impact of the climate crisis and what that means for our nation and, of course, us here in South Australia. And we've also seen a lot of action around the world in terms of various countries looking at what they can do to incentivize electric vehicles. The UK government recently announced that it will be banning the sale of petrol cars by 2030. And the Greens Labor government in the ACT is now offering electric vehicle buyers free registration and $15,000 loans to actually get an electric vehicle. Meanwhile, you've got the Victorian government that's introduced a electric vehicle tax and it's been condemned internationally. And now we've got the Liberals here in South Australia wanting to go down that path. So I'm going to now open up the discussion to our panel. And first, it's a real privilege to be able to welcome Sam Hibbins MP. He's the member for Paran in the Victorian Parliament, and he holds the portfolios of transport, education and LGBT equality for the Victorian Greens. In 2014, Sam made history by being one of the first ever Green MPs elected to the lower house in the Victorian Parliament, and he was re-elected in 2018, which I think is a fantastic achievement. Prior to entering the Victorian Parliament, Sam was a local government councillor, and when he was on council, he worked to secure sustainability programs, better bike infrastructure, more open space and active transport. Sam's a sports fan and a commuter cyclist, and he has a passion for people-friendly, sustainable, low-emission transport, and this almost outweighs his love of Star Wars. As someone who was sworn in on the 4th of May, Sam, I love the Star Wars as well. So welcome. Good to have you with us.
Terrific. Thank you. Thanks so much, Rob. And great to see you back in Parliament as well, which is just absolutely fantastic.
Oh, thank you.
And 4th of July. That's a great, what a great day to be sworn in. Look, I thought I'd take a run through essentially what's happened in Victoria, because as you might be aware, we're the only state now that has actually put through the EV tax. And so I just want to take you through how that actually played out and where we are now, and hopefully that'll inform how you can sort of campaign in South Australia and how you might best stop the tax in South Australia. So The tax was, the EV tax was first floated just after, I think it was first brought up in South Australia, where the government announced in its budget that it was going to introduce a road user charge on electric vehicles. And this was coming at a time, I'm not sure what the situation is like in South Australia, but in Victoria, transport is our biggest growing source of emissions. Unlike energy, it's heading north. And it's the biggest second only to, we've still got coal in Victoria, plenty of it. Second only biggest source of emissions only to coal. And they use a lot of the same discredited arguments that I'm sure is happening in South Australia as well. That somehow there's a link between fuel excise and paying for roads and what have you. Somehow this was all about fairness and, you know, listening to the debate in the Victorian Parliament, every Labor MP. I mean, this is coming from a Labor government, mind you. Was talking about fairness as if they'd introduced, you know, the welfare state. They leaned heavily, very heavily on this mythological fairness argument. But we led the charge against it here in the Victorian Parliament. And there was really big fears that this would catch on and go national. I remember we had a very early on, we had a similar forum with Greens MPs from around the country. It managed to bring industry and environment groups together, which has always been sometimes a challenge, but they were in lockstep in opposition to the EV tax, the worst electric vehicle policy in the world, they called it, and that was splashed across newspapers. In between their first announcing it and introducing the legislation, they did announce some incentives. It was, I guess you could describe it as better than nothing incentives, clearly aimed at taking the political heat out of the argument. And we called that out for what it was when they introduced it. It is around $3,000. I think the incentive for 3 years was what they announced, well below still what's being put in, what's around the world and what's being announced by other jurisdictions in Australia as well. When it came for the debate in the Victorian Parliament, we've got quite a diverse crossbench, so it's not something you can just sort of rely on, you know, one or two blocks of oppositions. It's quite diverse. But we spoke directly to them. We hosted meetings with them. We ran a campaign getting people to email them. Which they got bombarded by people who were opposed to this tax. Unfortunately, we were let down by the crossbenchers, particularly including progressive crossbenchers in Victoria, who ultimately supported the EV tax. And really, their arguments were just simply repeating government, government talking points. That somehow this was a holistic package they've announced, and really they were just making up policy on the run when it came to incentives to take the heat out of it. In looking back, look, we threw everything at it. In looking back, what could have we done differently or what could have we done better? I think we would have made perhaps a stronger argument to let our crossbenchers know and MPs that were on the fence that this isn't the end of it. That once this bill passes, this issue isn't going to go away. There's still going to be a concerted campaign by us and others to repeal the EV tax, to put in better incentives. There's going to be a lot of unhappy EV drivers out there who have done the right thing, who are now going to be receiving letters in the mail as what's happening here in Victoria. And, you know, just months after the bill was passed, you had EV drivers who haven't had a subsidy, who have done the right thing, essentially getting letters in the mail saying, you know, give us your odometer or your license or your registration is going to be suspended. And they were very, you know, obviously they're very unhappy about that. So, look, if there was something that I would do different in terms of our lobbying, it would be let them know that this isn't just we're gonna take a hit now and then move on. I'd let them know that this is a campaign that doesn't end if this bill passes, if the EV tax passes. It's going to be a concerted campaign continuing after that. And the only way really to end it is to vote against the bill. Here in Victoria, obviously, we've got a lot of unhappy EV drivers, and we've got a barrier. We've got a barrier now for people who are wanting to take up an EV. Even with the incentives announced, it's still a considerable price difference between a fuel car and a electric vehicle. And for those drivers who, again, many of them who are on the margins, just the simple fact that they're going to have this another layer of having to send in their odometer meter and pay up and what have you, that's still going to be a barrier to them taking up EVs. So that undermines whatever incentives the government has put in place. We don't necessarily know, the figures aren't necessarily out about how many have taken up these incentives. And I suspect we won't know the true figure for some time, given it could just be some latent demand that it's taking up at the moment. And really now, as a state, which once prided itself on being a leader when it came to climate action, you know, we're out in a rock. And it's no fun here in, I wouldn't want South Australia to join us. We're now really a lagger when it comes to EVs. You know, in addition to the great work that the Greens are doing in the ACT, New South Wales, I think it's $5,000 to $6,000, their incentives. They're not going to put in an EV charge until 2027 when there's significant uptake of EV. The Greens in New Zealand, you know, some fantastic incentives there, around $8,000. They've delayed their EV charge for another 3 years at least. And so, yeah, we're in a situation where, as a state, we're a bit of a laughingstock and a lagger when it comes to EV uptake, which is really, really disappointing as a Victorian. And, you know, I know in South Australia, you know, you pride yourself on being a leader as well in climate action. Taking, you know, we point to South Australia and a lot of what we do to see some of the work that you've done, and to undermine that as a state, but being out in a rock with Victoria, putting a charge on EVs now is not a great place to be. And so not only is the barrier towards, as you know, the emissions reductions that we need to do now, so much of now what we're hearing about how essential EVs are going to be to supporting the uptake of renewables, the stability in the grid, all that technology, this is not the time to be putting in an EV tax and a barrier to that. So we're going to continue on the fight to repeal the EV tax here in Victoria and to push for some really further and decent incentives for the uptake of EVs as well. So that's where we're at, Rob. All power to you in your campaign as well.
Thanks. Thanks very much, Sam. And keep up the fight. Solidarity. It's interesting for us in South Australia. We often, look to Victoria as being a progressive state and you know, a leader in so many of these areas. So it is really disappointing to see a state Labor government going down this path. And equally disappointing for us in South Australia to see our state Liberal government playing copycat with such a stupid policy.
Yeah.
Be great to continue to work together to try and knock
Absolutely.
It on the head.
Absolutely. I think it was Victoria that led the charge to actually get this up around the state through the Board of Treasurers meeting, what have you. So they're the first ones that's jumped in, and it hasn't been particularly successful. So
no.
Them, so
no, it's certainly gone over like a lead balloon in most places. Mm. Well, I'm going to introduce Christine Milne now, and I feel like Christine almost needs no introduction to people here on the Zoom, because we all know her through her work as a lifelong environmental activist, of course as former leader of the Greens, and she was also appointed to Australia's first ever Greenhouse Gas Council in 1990, and she's been passionate about addressing global warming ever since. In her federal parliamentary career, Christine made it signature policy for the Greens and was instrumental in securing a carbon price, a world-leading carbon price at the time, the ARENA, the CEFC, the CCA, and the Carbon Farming Initiative. And having retired from parliamentary politics, she now works with 10 NGOs on climate, biodiversity, and justice. It's great to have you with us, Christine.
Thanks very much, Rob, and great to see you in the South Australian Parliament after a considerable contribution in the Senate. So delighted to be able to join you tonight. I'd like to begin by acknowledging that I'm on the land of the Mohonina people, the traditional owners, and I pay my respects to their elders, past, present, and emerging. First thing I'd like to say about this electric vehicle tax is that unfortunately it's being discussed in the wrong context. It has been brought right down to this conversation about fairness and about equity instead of the big picture conversation we should be having, which is we're talking about a broad emissions reduction strategy in which transport is a considerable component. And it's worth noting that since 1990, transport emissions in Australia have almost doubled and would have doubled if it hadn't been for the pandemic last year. That is the trajectory. So we're talking about electric vehicles in the context of emissions reduction strategy and an increasing profile for transport emissions. Second thing is you can't talk about electric vehicles on their own. You have to talk about a transport strategy, which is about transport on water, rail, road, paths, and air. So all of those are pathways for emissions or emissions reductions. And so you have to see what a green strategy on transport has to essentially start with the alignment of transport, infrastructure, and land use strategies, which of course we've always done, because we've recognised that frequently poorer people have to live further from the centre of the city in areas that are not served by public transport. They tend to drive the older vehicles because that's what they can afford, and so then they have greater emissions and so on. So you have to align land use and planning strategies with your transport corridors and, of course, the infrastructure that you're going to need, so that your building codes have to be aligned with this if you're going to have a strategy of getting people to reduce their transport or to move to lighter transport with low emissions, with walking, cycling, rail, and so on. You have to provide them with the lockers. You have to provide them with the showers. You have to provide them with the ability to get the bike on the train and so on and so forth. So this has to be, electric vehicles have to be seen as one strategy in addressing emissions reduction. So in looking at electric vehicles, I'll just, Rob asked me to go through what we'd actually done in the Senate over the years. And it actually is a long list when you think about it, starting right back in 2005, when we moved for an inquiry into peak oil and the implications for Australia's energy security of being so dependent on foreign oil, and we needed to get more into less intensive transport emissions and, of course, a more secure future, which of course involved electric vehicles. I brought up re-energising Australia in 2006 before the 2007 election, and that was very strongly around increasing vehicle fuel efficiency and emission standards and bringing in electric vehicles. And in fact, when we were elected to the Senate that year, the Greens had to get an exemption from the federal parliament in order to be able to have a Prius, because at that time you had to have, you could have any vehicle made in Australia or assembled or made in Australia. It could be as big and huge and gas guzzling and whatever as you like, but you couldn't actually have a vehicle that was fuel efficient or a hybrid. And we had to get an exemption, and everybody was horrified that the Greens would do that. But it actually brought home to me how important it was in a state like Tasmania, for example, because Bob and I both had Priuses, and the taxi drivers kept ringing to see when we would be changing over the Priuses, because they were desperate to get them into the taxi fleet. And that just made me aware of how important governments driving the rollout in fleets and so on is so important to then get it into the secondhand market so it spreads in deeper into the broader community. When Anthony Albanese was the infrastructure minister under Rudd or Gillard, I went to see him about saying we had to improve our fuel quality standards and we had to improve our vehicle emission standards. They didn't do anything about it. And I even put to him that it was time in Australia we had a uniform plan for charging stations, so we didn't end up like we had with computers with and phones, where everyone had a different mechanism so that you had to pay for it over and over again or go to their specific charging station. But I also asked him about bi-directional electric vehicles. When would we get to a time when we could shave the peak off our electricity demand by having people plug their vehicle in and download to the grid, so that your vehicle actually made you money for once instead of costing you money? He brought in his advisors at the time, who said they didn't really know what I was talking about, but no, they had nobody working on it, no one was looking at it, and so on and so forth. And that was back in 2007 and 8. And I suspect to this day, there is still no one looking at how soon bi-directional vehicles will be developed and possible, and how that will fit into microgrids and so on. During the Labor-Green agreement, the Multi-Party Climate Committee, we secured a Productivity Commission investigation into this whole issue of fuel excise, road user charges, because I could see this was coming, and that if you were to have a revolution in transport, then you would have to shift everything onto road user and get rid of fuel excise. That's clearly the long-term way it had to go. Ken Henry also recommended that in the 2010 tax reform, but unfortunately, the Multi-Party Climate Committee wasn't able to impose a carbon price on the transport sector because Tony Windsor wouldn't vote for it, because he argued that people in rural areas didn't have alternatives and so on. Of course, then we moved on to the South Australian car industry. And again, the Greens argued stop giving them Commonwealth funding to build big six-cylinder cars to sell to Saudi Arabia. Let's start building electric vehicles and build an electric vehicle industry in Australia, and then we don't mind subsidising them. They wouldn't listen to that. They didn't even approach any of the companies assembling cars in Australia to go electric and build electric platforms, you know, car platforms. And so we lost the car industry. And I think that's because they failed to make them be innovative. Then, of course, we got to the 2014 budget, when Tony Abbott wanted to increase the fuel excise, and that was a policy that we had had for a long time, so as a disincentive to use more fuel, but he hypothecated the money that was the extra money that was to be raised for freeways. So it was to fund East-West Link in Melbourne, WestConnex in Sydney, Row 8 in Western Australia, and so on. That was an absolute disaster, that this was actually going to create more congestion, more problems in the transport sector than less. So it has, the Greens have had a long history in engaging in this whole issue and trying to promote electric vehicles, and of course we still do. The main issue here is it should not be a state by state thing. This is a national policy to bring down emissions in the transport sector, and it has to be integrated. If you're going to talk about fast rail, it's obviously between states. If you're going to talk about imposing, as Sam's just said, in Victoria, a road user charge, what happens when you drive from Victoria to Sydney and back? That's on your odometer. You're going to pay the Victorian government for the roads that you've just driven on in New South Wales. I mean, this is, we're back to the days of the old difference in the rail network. We absolutely have to have a national policy on this, but I think in the longer term, it does need to be a road user charge and get away from fuel excise. But that has to be national, and it has to be a longer time frame, and it has to be in the context of several other things. And so I'll just quickly go through some of the policy incentives that need to be in place. And the first one clearly is you need a national target for reducing carbon emissions in the transport sector, and within that a national target for the take up of EVs. And that can be differentiated around the states, but you need a national target because you need to send a signal to the car manufacturers that there is a market for this number of electric vehicles in Australia, because at the moment we don't even get the choice because they're not sending them here because there's no incentive to actually do that. The second thing, of course, upfront, there is a monetary reward in some cases to bring down the upfront cost. And I wanted to mention the good car company out of Tasmania, which, again, it goes to this issue of equity, Sam. They have, it's a community group, and they order secondhand electric vehicles in bulk in order to bring down the price, and they then offer a warranty on the battery and so on after that. And there's a story about them, which I think Emily might put up in the chat for me. Just they're moving to the mainland as well. So that idea of community groups having bulk buys of secondhand electric vehicles is a good one. Also, we need targets for the government transport fleets. So local government fleets, state government fleets, government business enterprise fleets, we need those incentives and targets. And in some states they've done that. But in Hobart, for example, the biggest fleets are the university, the hospital, and the Hobart City Council are the three biggest transport fleets. And imagine how quickly you'd get those vehicles into the secondhand market if you required the uptake of electric vehicles in a short time in those fleets. So that's important. Privately, also the private transport fleets, you know, the Woolworths, the Deliveries, there's so many of them, we need to put some pressure on, especially through CO2, if that's the advantage of having CO2 emissions and also targets for uptake of electric vehicles, you'll get them into those private fleets as well. We need non-dollar incentives. So you need things like they've done in London, where if you're driving an electric vehicle, you get access to the transit lanes. So you're not stuck in miles of congestion. You can go through the transit lanes. There are discounts on parking for electric vehicles. There's preferential parking for electric vehicles, and there's discounts on road tolls. So there's all manner of different incentives that you can incorporate as well as or instead of the upfront one, including discounted registration fees, including exemptions from your luxury vehicle tax, including exemptions from stamp duty. There's a whole gamut of things that you can do. So my argument about Victoria and South Australia, these are random interventions because people are annoyed that people driving electric vehicles aren't paying fuel excise. There is no consideration that they are making a contribution to improved air quality. No consideration about the contribution they're making to reducing emissions. It is just a particularly small targeted policy in the absence of a bigger picture context. And so my advice to the Greens would be to put electric vehicles back into the bigger picture context of a national strategy for reducing emissions in transport, and then going as we've always done with the prioritising public transport, prioritising urban design, vehicle ways, bicycle ways, walking, you know, the 20-minute suburb and so on. And then when you get to electric vehicles, putting them in that context of a broad range of incentives, but putting the pressure back on the federal government in the tax policy review to actually recognise this needs to be a road user charge for everyone. And that could include concepts around congestion taxes, time of use, those sorts of things. So it's a big policy area, it's an exciting policy area, and it's pathetic to see these governments reduce it to one disconnected policy position, and that's why it's been rightly condemned. Thanks, Rob.
Thanks so much, Christine. And, you know, it's really interesting to hear about what's happening overseas and in other jurisdictions, and you just look at what's happening at the federal level, you know, slow-mo, totally missing in action in terms of doing anything about these things. It's interesting also that you talked about the ministerial car fleet. This has been an issue for us here in South Australia too, where the state Liberal government have only got four out of their ministerial fleet that are electric vehicles. And it's something that we're continuing to push in the parliament to say, you know, why on earth are they not leading by example in terms of, you know, putting their money where their mouth is on some of this stuff. So there's so many great ideas there and things that we can be following up on.
Rob, I should have just mentioned, obviously the investment in the charging infrastructure is critical, and that's where forward thinking is required as well, because the electric vehicles are becoming so much more efficient and their range so much larger that people need to be thinking in the big picture, otherwise we'll be putting money into charging stations in the wrong place and even unnecessarily given the rapid shift in the technologies. Thanks, Rob, sorry.
Yeah, absolutely. Christine mentioned before in her presentation about an article in the Fifth Estate on the Good Car Company. You'll just see that that's been posted in the chat box. So if you're interested in having a look at that, you can capture that. The other thing I just want to put on people's agenda before I move on to the next speaker is we'll have about 15 minutes at the end for questions. So if you've got any things that are coming to mind, feel free to write them in the chat box and then I'll ask them for you when we move into the question period. So next I'm going to introduce Noah Schultz-Byard, who is the SA director of the independent think tank, the Australia Institute. Noah is a communications professional and a former ABC reporter, and he now leads the Institute's presence here in South Australia, focusing on issues of economic inequality, environmental sustainability, and climate change. He's previously worked as a media advisor and as a communications consultant for a range of organisations. And Noah has a passion for using evidence-based research to tell compelling stories and to engage with the community. So it's great to have you with us, Noah. Welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me along tonight for this important discussion. I just want to say at the offset, I'm coming to you from the lands of the Kaurna people as well, just like Rob, and I pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. So like I say, thanks for having me along tonight, but also I wanted to say thanks to Rob for the stance that you've taken against the EV tax in the Parliament and your work on this issue. It's really appreciated, and a really important part of the conversation here in SA is the leadership being offered by the Greens and then later, a bit later down the track, by Labor in opposing the EV tax after it was first announced. Just briefly, the Australia Institute, we're an independent think tank primarily based in Canberra, but we have offices in other states. I'm the director of the Institute here in South Australia. And through our climate and energy program, mainly, we've done a fair bit of work looking at electric vehicles over the years. And a lot of our work in South Australia over the last year has been looking at the EV tax, the way that it's been rolled out in other jurisdictions, and the ways that it could be improved here in South Australia. The main reason the Institute is interested in the issue of electric vehicles and the EV taxes is, as Christine mentioned, transport is the area of the Australian economy or the sector with the fastest growing carbon emissions footprint. Nationally now, just under a fifth of Australia's carbon emissions come from the transport sector. That figure has been rising, but it's actually a worse picture here in South Australia, where nearly a third of our state's carbon pollution comes from transport. A part of that is because of the good work that's being done in transitioning our energy sector to renewable energy. But it's really disappointing to see those gains made in one sector being given up in the transport sector as those emissions increase. We have seen a dip in emissions from transport through the COVID crisis, of course, because of the lockdowns, but the National Energy Emissions Audit, which is another piece of research that comes out of the Australia Institute, shows that the emissions are heading back up to their standard levels and are actually predicted to return to normal, potentially more so than where we were before the COVID pandemic hit, staggeringly quickly when we return to normal. So there's been a very temporary dip, but it's not a sign of any sort of positive direction or health in the way things are going with emissions in transport. A big part of that is the small vehicles, light vehicles sector, the types of cars that we all drive for our day-to-day transport, makes up a huge section of our transport emissions. And frankly, in Australia, we have a situation where just not enough of the cars we drive are electric vehicles. Last year, the number of cars sold that were electric or plug-in hybrid electric was less than 1%. We were at 0.7% of sales being EVs, which is just a pitiful number to land at. The world leaders are light years ahead of us in Norway, which has the highest uptake of electric vehicles. They're in a position now where more than 75% of new cars sold are electric. And you might well say, well, that's all well and good for the Nordic nations. They're always good at this sort of thing. But if you look at the OECD average, group of countries that Australia is often compared to, the average in that sector is 10% of new car sales being EVs. And even globally, the average is around 5% of new cars being EVs. So Australia's rate of 0.7% as EVs is abysmally poor. A big part of that is the policy situation at a national level. It was interesting, Bloomberg published a study a little while ago looking at analyzing the transport decarbonization policies of all G20 nations and then ranked them. And unfortunately, drum roll please, Australia didn't do very well. We came in third worst out of the G20 nations. We're ahead of only Russia and Saudi Arabia when it comes to our policy settings for reducing carbon from our transport sector. So there's a huge amount of work that needs to be done. Of course, as we've noted and the other speakers have said, EVs are good for a range of reasons. The three large ones that I see are reducing carbon pollution, of course, but also reducing air pollution and improving the health through cleaning the air that we breathe. There's a huge problem of lung disease related to how polluted our air is, emphysema and asthma, that has flow-on effects that go on to our publicly funded health system. All of that would be cleaned up if we could switch to cleaner forms of transport. But also, it would be good for national security if we switched to electric vehicles. And that's because Australia's capacity to refine fuel is very low and is declining. We're beholden to international fossil fuel suppliers. The fuel comes through rather unstable supply chains that are quite volatile. And it's been a long running problem in Australia, that we don't have sufficient reserves of fuel to guarantee national security in a crisis for any meaningful length of time. So if we could switch to electrified transport, we would no longer be beholden on these volatile supply chains for such a key part of our society and our security. A whole range of other reasons: less noise pollution, grid support, as Christine mentioned, passing the energy back and forward to stabilize the grid in moments of peak demand, or to absorb excess power when there is peak supply. The supply curve of energy throughout the day has changed massively over just the last 5 years. And if we all had big batteries on wheels sitting in our garages or carports that could soak up that excess energy when it was needed and then send it out when it was needed more, it would make a huge difference to the investment required in generation infrastructure to flatten out those curves. I don't need to convince you about electric vehicles. The reasons are numerous. So one of the problems about how we've ended up where we are is that there hasn't been an overarching national strategy for how to increase EV uptake. We were told that the federal government would be releasing one in 2019. That was delayed until early 2020. That was delayed again until late 2020. And then it was delivered in 2021. But rather than being a comprehensive suite of policies that would turbocharge the transition to electric that has to happen for so many reasons, we got a discussion paper called the Future Fuels Strategy, or FFS, And unfortunately, the FFS offered SFA for electric vehicle policy in this country. There was no new funding for electric vehicles. There was no targets for EVs and no emission standards. And the document ruled out incentives or taxation waivers at a federal level to increase the uptake of EVs. So it's been left to the states. The federal government has effectively vacated the field, and it's been left to the states to come up with their own electric vehicle policies. And we now have this hodgepodge mismatch of different strategies being taken around different parts of the country, creating a mess of laws and systems. But unfortunately, one consistent theme through a lot of the packages that are being proposed by the different states is a road user charge for EVs, an EV tax. They say it has to come in to replace the fuel excise. Otherwise, how are we going to pay for our roads? Well, the fuel excise hasn't been hypothecated to roads funding for a very long time in Australia. The roads aren't funded by the fuel excise, partially because the fuel excise doesn't raise enough money to pay for the roads. More is invested in roads and highways and maintenance than is raised by the fuel tax every year. But the fuel tax goes into consolidated government revenue at a federal level anyway, creating a whole new stream of revenue directly to the state governments that also goes into general revenue doesn't solve the problems that the state governments say they're trying to. Also, we need to have a conversation about why move to a user pays system for essential public infrastructure. You know, I think of roads as an essential part of the way we live our lives. We don't expect a user pays system when we go to the hospital. You don't get a bill in Australia under Medicare for going to hospital. And when you call a police officer, you don't get a call out fee for hassling them because we've decided that they are public goods and that we shouldn't have a user pays system. I believe the same should be true for roads, but if the governments are committed to going through with a road user charge, as Christine said, let's charge for congestion, the number of axles a vehicle has, how heavy it is, the time of day you use it, but more importantly, the pollution that that vehicle creates for the climate and for air health. Let's take those economic externalities and internalize them by coming up with a comprehensive road user charge. It's probably not going to happen. It's a complex policy area. Governments are a little bit scared of that level of detail and reality and coming down on the fossil fuels that people love. So it's not going to happen, but we definitely shouldn't be proceeding with a narrow tax on electric vehicles. Just quickly, a little bit of the research from the Australia in South Australia, there's a range of policies that people do support for increasing EVs. People want the government to buy electric vehicles. They want the government to build a network of charging station. They want fuel efficiency standards for new cars to be more efficient and mandated to be that way. Apartment blocks should include electric chargers, according to a majority of South Australians. They want the luxury car tax removed from EVs. They want the government to provide loans for the purchasing of EVs and a range of other policies. I also, we have new research coming out soon, hopefully later this week or next week. South Australian purchases, which is a major problem. So we have a situation where Victoria legislation charged at 2.5 cents per kilometre travelled in an electric vehicle, and it also hits plug-in electric vehicles for 2 cents per kilometre. So it's a unique problem for plug-in hybrids because they're getting charged 2 cents a kilometre EV tax, and then if they're short fully electric battery runs out and they switch to petrol, they're still paying the EV tax for the kilometers they drive in that mode and the fuel excise tax. It's a complete mess. The New South Wales government's package is far superior to the Victorian government. The way that they've gone with the same upfront incentives as Victoria, but have permanent stamp duty waivers for electric vehicles that last forever, and they don't introduce their road user charge until 2027 or when EVs are 30% of new car sales. So with that permanent stamp duty waiver as an incentive, there's genuine give and take and real support for the sector for the crucial period where it's becoming established. I'll wrap it up there, but to be here, great to have the support of the Greens in the Parliament on this important issue. If it weren't for the stand that the Greens were taking on this issue in the upper house, I feel that this legislation would have passed already, probably back when it was first announced in SA in November last year. So it's important work that's being done. Thank you for standing up for it, and thanks for having me.
Hey, thanks very much, Noah, and thank you for the work of the Australia Institute on this, because, you know, it's really important that we've got the community and the Parliament working together to kind of, you know, shut this down and make sure this doesn't progress. It's so interesting to hear those statistics around the low take-up that's happening in terms of electric cars. I mean, it's staggering when you consider what's happening over in the United States as well, and, you know, Joe Biden setting these targets over the last few days. And yet we've got nothing happening here at a national level in Australia. It's really embarrassing, an indictment on the government. I've got a few comments coming up in the feed here. So I'm just going to quickly work through those. One of those is, what is the value of the Victorian electric vehicle tax? How is it calculated? Now, I assume when the person's asking about the value, Jack's meaning how much money is it raising? Sam, do you want to take this one?
Yeah, it's about, I think it's around $10 million a year. So it's around $40 million over 4 years in the forward estimates of the budget. And what was quite interesting, was quite amusing, is that they would, on one hand, the government would point to this EV tax paying for all these sorts of things. It was going to pay for all these new charging stations. It was going to pay for new roads. It was going to pay for road maintenance. And so this $40 million was going to go a very long way to paying for all these things related to EVs and roads. But at the same time, they're spending more on EVs than they are collecting from the EV tax. So they weren't quite sure whether it was paying for all these things, or they were paying a lot more than they were collecting for EVs. So it was a very confused argument, and I'm sure you'll probably find the same sorts of things. South Australia, when they progressed that, they couldn't quite make up their mind on that one. So it's not bringing in a lot of money at this point. And as has been rightly pointed out, it's just undermining, at a time when we need to be embedding EVs in and getting them on the people to change over. Small amount of revenue being raised, it's doing a lot of damage.
And, you know, not much money to make for the amount of bad press that they've generated either.
Exactly.
Terrible reputational damage. There's a comment here from Rebecca, who's mentioned in relation to your article, Christine, about the good car company, around secondhand vehicle costs, and said that they're still quite prohibitive for people who are on low incomes, and asked whether the Greens have a plan to ensure those who are unable to afford the cost of EVs do not pay a poverty premium for not being able to make the shift. The ACT has a no interest loan scheme, but perhaps there's more work that should be done around this. Christine, do you have a view on that one?
Well, certainly it's been the case. People on low income struggle and struggle to get work in several areas because they don't have access to private transport and there is no public transport. So this comes down to regional and urban planning, public transport provision, and the planning of these areas. But notwithstanding that, we've got what we've got and people are stuck in areas and don't have access. And certainly I think the low interest or no interest loans are important, but I can't speak for the Greens because I don't know what their policy position is at the moment. Sam might be in a better position to know that, but I know that the idea of a community group like the Good Car, that's why I brought the model of a community group just getting together and importing a critical mass of secondhand vehicles and selling them at a reasonable price in a non-profit is a very green way of going about it and sharing those benefits. And in fact, it's a flow on from what we did with solar panels when they were so expensive in the early years, and solar hot water, for example. We had a lot of community bulk buys in order to make things affordable. So I think that's probably all I can say on that, Rob.
And can I just add, from an SA Greens perspective, it's certainly one of the things we're looking at as well in terms of, you know, crafting our policy on electric vehicles heading into the next state election, is what can we do to encourage their use among people who are on low incomes, and how can we subsidise that and encourage that, so that, you know, recognising that it's not something that only those on high incomes can, you know, should be able to afford to do. We've got to make that transition easy for people. There's a question here on hybrid vehicles. What about you, Noah? Do you have a view on that and where they fit?
Yeah, it's one of the problems with the way that the EV charge has been set up, that it captures plug-in hybrid vehicles as well. And in both Victoria and New South Wales, in the way that they've announced their packages, plug-in hybrid vehicles get hit with the tax, but they don't actually qualify for the incentives that are being offered up, sort of as the spoonful of sugar to help the medicine go down. So the stamp duty waiver in New South Wales and the incentive, the subsidy there, as well as the subsidy in Victoria, doesn't apply. But as I said before, if you're a plug-in hybrid driver, and you're driving in electric mode, you're paying the EV tax. If you're driving in petrol mode, you're paying the EV tax and the fuel excise on top of that. I've heard from discussions I've had with automakers and car dealers in South Australia that their colleagues in Victoria are getting furious calls from plug-in hybrid owners who are saying, you know, we were trying to do the right thing, we couldn't switch to full electric for whatever reason. And then out of nowhere, we get hit with this sort of double whammy where we're being taxed in two different ways. It could be argued that the plug-in hybrids are extending the life of fossil fuels, but really we're so far behind in Australia that any step towards electrification, including plug-in hybrids, would be a positive thing. And plug-in hybrids are going to play a role in the transition, so they should be better supported than they are.
Would anyone else like to comment on that, Christine?
I was just going to add to that. One of the issues that why people have gone to plug-in hybrids is range anxiety. People are worried that maybe they might have to drive 500 Ks somewhere and there won't be a charging station, or, you know, various issues. I think this comes down to public education, where people need to now be aware that a ride in Australia is 48 kilometres, something like that, if you take the national, not just the urban. The range is now almost up to 400, if not more, 400 kilometres. So I think the hybrids, you know, dare I say, gas was a transition fuel in 1990, and the transition is well and truly over, and was over
here, by
the century. So I regard hybrids, non-plug-in and plug-in hybrids, as the transition technology, as people got over their range anxiety, because I think that's the main reason why people have them. But as soon as fully electric vehicles have public confidence about range, then I think they're just going to be a thing of the past. The second thing is, I've always worried that because Australia is so far behind the eight ball and Europe is moving so fast, the States is moving so fast, that we'll end up being a dumping ground for everybody who wants to get a Jag or a Volvo or something, because in Europe they won't be able to sell them after 2025. So why not dump a load of them in Australia? But I am relieved. One of the issues about us having such poor fuel quality standards in this country and emissions standards in this country is the quality of our fuel is so bad that those cars won't run on them. They're too finely tuned and there's too much problem with them. So in many ways, Australia has managed to shoot itself in the foot even to get the better secondhand models out of Europe. So I see hybrids as genuinely a transition. I think it's been important because it's been given people the confidence in electric cars. They won't ever go back to a full fuel, petrol or diesel vehicle, and they will rapidly go to an electric as soon as it's affordable. So I think the two things are range anxiety and affordability. And once we get over those, I think hybrids are a thing of the past.
I think just some of the issues that Noah pointed out in Victoria, where you've got plug-in hybrids being charged and non-plug-in hybrids not being charged, just shows the rushed nature of what happened in Victoria with no consultation with the industry until they actually announced the thing. And again, another reason why South Australia shouldn't proceed at this moment too. It's far too early.
Absolutely. One of the questions that's been asked here, and I'll have this as our final question, is around the role of fossil fuel companies and vested interests making donations to political parties. And it's been asked here whether or not that's one of the reasons that they're not taking the action that we need in terms of promoting electric vehicles. I might start with you on this one first, Christine, because I know you've got strong views around the role of big money in politics.
Yeah, absolutely. Look, there's no doubt about that. If you have a look at, as I said, Tony Windsor strongly opposed a carbon price on transport during the multi-party climate commission because of rural and regional Australia. If you look at who the big donors are to both major parties, but particularly the LNP, the big transport companies, those huge trucks that thunder around the highways and actually get a reduced fuel excise, a lower fuel excise than light vehicles, tells you the political influence of those big road transport companies. If they were charged a fuel excise that reflected the weight of the vehicle and the damage they do to the roads, we would have had the shift from roads to rail a long time ago in terms of freight. So a lot of money goes into federal politics to keep the fuel excise discount on heavy vehicles and to head off any shift into electrics. The hope will be here, not from the politicians or from those big transport companies, if we get to hydrogen fueling heavy vehicles and ferries and the like, then you might get a shift, but it'll be technology-led rather than politically-led, because there's just too much money goes into securing the profits of heavy road transport.
Mm. And in I think the privatisation lobby, your Transurbans and some of your big infrastructure lobbyists as well, my concern when the Victorian tax was introduced was twofold. Number one was the potential that a road user charge could be privatised. It could, instead of going into public coffers, it could be the rights to a road user charge could be sold off. That would be an absolute disaster because essentially it would be run for private profit. And two, it's pretty clear that the privatisation lobby, your infrastructure partnerships style groups, they want the merry-go-round of money coming in from fuel excise to money going out to pay for new roads. That's pretty clear what that's their agenda. When in reality, in the long term, if we're looking at a road user charge across the entire network, it should be designed so we've got less cars on the road, so we're not having to build giant new freeways, so we're managing demand. And I think if you can see some of these companies that want to get their hands on it, that would be all about private profit, making sure that there were more cars on the road, more private profit going to more big freeways, a cycle that would never end. That would be an absolute disaster. Any road user charge needs to be both broad-based, but it needs to remain in the public hands. And you know, I've seen a lot of state governments that even in Victoria jumping on the privatisation sell-off bandwagon. It's no doubt that any treasurer who's trying to balance their budget in the future would be eyeing off selling off the rights to a road user charge. So one to look out for.
Yeah, absolutely. And Noah, did you want to comment on that?
The only thing I'll add is that the influence of money and lobbyists in this picture is really clear, because there's a think tank called the IPA, which is not the IPA that most people know. There's a think tank called Infrastructure Partnerships Australia, which happens to share an acronym, unfortunately, with the other IPA.
They need to rename themselves, I reckon. Time for a rebrand.
Yeah, but Infrastructure Partnerships Australia are a lobby group that have pushed for the EV tax, and they are, of course, funded by toll roads and infrastructure companies from around the country. It's self-interest, really, and the meddling impact of money in politics is a disaster for the country, and a part of why the Australia Institute has recently launched its Democracy and Accountability Program to look more into these sorts of links between money on one hand and policy decisions that are holding Australia back on the other.
Yeah, it's like, how can we have a prime minister that's kissing a piece of coal in the middle of a, you know, climate crisis? Follow the money, hey? Look, I'm afraid that's bringing us to the close of our forum tonight, but I want to thank our speakers, Sam Hibbins, Christine Milne, and Noah Schultz-Byard, and thank you everybody for joining us tonight. This is really, you know, part of an ongoing campaign for us here in South Australia. So if you'd like to get involved, I'll send you a link to my website. It's robertsims.org.au. Sign up if you're an SA and join the campaign against the electric vehicle tax, because we're really hopeful we can defeat this in the parliament, but we need to work with all of you to make that happen. I also do just want to, before we wrap up, give a quick plug to remind everybody to complete the census, which is happening tonight. Remember, this is important data that we need to provide, so get on there and do it. And also just to wish all of our friends well in New South Wales and Victoria who are dealing with lockdowns at the moment. You're in our thoughts, and, you know, we wish you all the best, and stay safe.
Thanks, Rob.
Thanks.
Appreciate it. Thanks very much, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.